Hello students, this is Vinita Gupta, Associate Professor of English, Government PG College, Sector 1, Panchkula. I am here to discuss with you the poem, The Road Not Taken, composed by the renowned American poet Robert Frost. This lecture of mine is part of a series of lectures which are governed by the Department of Higher Education, Haryana, to impart e-learning to the students of the different universities of Haryana. So let us start with our lecture, and I hope that you will listen to it carefully and try to understand the basic concept and basic theme which runs behind this poem. To begin with, let us know something about the poet Robert Frost. Students, as I have told you, Robert Frost was an American poet of 20th century. He is often called the modern poet, and he is most widely admired and a highly honored poet. He was born in 1874 in San Francisco, and then his family moved to Lawrence, Massachusetts, because his ancestors were originally New Englanders. And New England is the place in USA where the English people got settled when they colonized America. Frost graduated from Lawrence School in 1892, and then he got published his first poem 2 years later, but then the publishers rejected his poems, and frustrated, he moved to England in 1912. Where he stayed till 1915. And students, in England, he got fame as a poet, and he also got professional success there. And in England, 2 volumes of his poetry came out. First was A Boy's Will in 1913, and North of Boston in 1914. And with these 2 poems, his reputation as a poet got established. 1915 year, he returned to United States, and he was the first poet and only poet who got Pulitzer Prizes 4 times, and he was also considered to be the poet laureate, though unofficially, of USA before he died in 1963. And here you can see in the picture, this is Frost Estate in New England. And regarding Robert Frost, as you know that he was a poet of 20th century, so he is called a modern poet of America, and all his poems revolved around his native place, Boston, Massachusetts, and all around, and that's why he is often labeled as the regional poet. He tries to present realistically his surroundings, his scenes, his settings. They are taken from his surroundings. That's why he is called the realistic poet also. But students, behind all this realism and regionalism, there lies philosophical content, and he is known for that philosophical content, that his poetry is concerned about the problems of existence of modern man. These are some of other works of Robert Frost. You can go through it and to understand his poetry. Let us have a look at the basic features, basic characteristics of Frost's poetry. As first point, you might be remembering now that he had the themes, and these themes revolve around his native place, New England, because he loved that place very much, and he was enamored by, he liked the rural life there. He presents a realistic picture of that rural life, and all this realism, it is a means for Robert Frost to search for meaning in the modern world, and he deals with complex social and philosophical themes in his poetry. And he tries to examine, and he tries to come to terms to the human condition in modern world, which was torn by 2 world wars. And in his poetry, the special characteristics of characteristic of Frost is that he uses dramatic monologues also and dialogues. For example, in the famous poem In Mending Wall, there is a conversation between the two neighbors who are indifferent to each other and who believe in creation of boundaries. So such type of philosophical themes that in the modern world, human beings doesn't believe in fraternity, companionship, brotherhood, and people are moving in their own respective cells. In Frost poetry, so we see that there are metaphysical concerns and metaphysical issues are addressed to in his poetry, because to Frost, the life was very tragic. He held an austere and tragic view of life. And I quote from a book, Contemporary Literary Criticism, which is edited by Jane Stein, Bridget Broderick, and Daniel Marowski. They state, I quote, Frost's best work explores fundamental questions of existence, depicting with chilling starkness the loneliness of the individual in an indifferent universe. They want to say that in Frost poetry, our world has been shown as indifferent to human problems. Individuals here, they have become lonely, isolated, and they have separated their bonds with fellow human beings, and they are cut off from their nature also. So Frost realism and his look at the region around him, it is a means to reach at some solutions to the problems of existential problems in the modern world. Frost's other characteristic is that he loved metaphors very much. Example, I quote, he himself says, I quote, man might be alone in an ultimately indifferent universe, but he may nevertheless look to natural world for metaphors of his own condition. Let me explain you in simple Hindi words. According to Frost, this world has become indifferent. It is not concerned with human problems. The nature has turned against human beings. But human beings can find solace by seeking comparison from the world of nature. We can see that his condition is reflected in the objects of nature also. So he gives symbolic meaning to the mundane facts, to everyday facts of life. And I quote once again a critic that these simple facts, he tries to find the ordinary world, a matrix for the extraordinary. I unquote here. Next aspect of Robert Frost was that in his poetry we find a mixture of both traditionalism and the modernism. That he was closer to the traditional writers in the use of meters in his poetry. He doesn't try to discover new forms for poetry, rather he used the traditional forms because he didn't want to waste his time, according to Robert Frost, that it was a wastage of time to go in search of new forms, because he was more concerned about the human condition and its presentation. And the 20th century aspect of his poetry is that his poetry is idiomatic. For human conditions, he tries to seek idioms in nature, and he has brought his poetry, the poetic language, to the colloquial speech of everyday life. Amy Lowell, his contemporary, has written about Robert Frost, I quote, he writes in classic meters and uses inversions and cliches whenever he pleases. So let us come to the poem, The Road Not Taken, and here is a pictorial presentation of the theme. You can see the forest which is covered with yellow leaves, and here one road here, it is divided into two directions. It is going into two directions. This is the basic dilemma, this is the basic problem that is presented in the poem. If you look at the title carefully, The Road Not Taken, the poet is not talking about the path, the direction, the choice which he has made in his life. Rather, he is talking about the other option that was available to him at the time of making choice. And the title itself shows the road not taken, the regret of the narrator of the poem on not being able to explore the other path, the other direction in life, because he feels that it might have been that this way, this path, this direction might have proved more beneficial to him. He might have achieved something more there. So this dilemma and this regret and this condition of discontent has been presented in this poem, The Road Not Taken. And a critic has said that through this poem, Robert Frost wanted to promote individualism and non-conformity. That is the path which the poet persona or the narrator adopted, that was different from the path adopted by the common man, because he wanted to do something different from the established norms of the society. So this poem is philosophical in nature, and this is a narrative poem, that is, it is in the written in the form of telling a story or an event that happened to the narrator, and it is a lyrical poem. We will understand these terms in my lecture. This poem was published in the volume Mountain Interval in 1916. And as I have told, this presents the dilemma of modern man of decision making. And as per my understanding, students, here the writer might have been talking about the conflict between physical desires and spiritual needs. Everybody has these conflicts. Everybody faces this problem, whether we should go in search of spiritual needs, whether we should go to seek the meaning of this life and to reach the ultimate, the God which we call Him. Or is this world real before us, which is lying before us, this world of material things, this beautiful world, this presents our physical desires. So, which of these two words we should adopt? Whether should we should go and satisfy our physical needs, physical desires, or we should understand the needs of our own spirit, which hankers, which craves for some higher goals. So, this conflict is a sort of universal conflict which is running inside human being, which is running with the growth of humanity throughout the ages. And this theme is presented through the motif of journey. So, Frost tries to highlight the habit of human beings, the habit of regretting any choice made. That is the discontent and dissatisfaction which is a part of human psyche. And also he tries to present the concept, the theme that the fate is always unpredictable because we cannot look into the future. We cannot see the future beforehand. And he has also made use of irony and satire in his poem. And the meter presented here is iambic tetrameter, each line having 4 2-syllable feet, a little variation, and rhymes with a little variation. Rhyme scheme is A-B-A-A-B. Let us now have a look at some of the literary terms which are related to this poem. You should know these terms before commencing on the understanding of the poem. But this poem is a lyric. A lyric is a short poem which expresses personal emotions, feelings, thoughts, perceptions. And as you will see, as you will read this poem, you will find that this is written in first person. I have said that this poem has a journey motif. And what is a motif? It is a usually recurring, silent, thematic element or the central theme of any literary work. Now, there are some figures of speech used in the poem. And what is a figure of speech? It is a literary device. And this device is used for any intentional deviation on the part of the writer from the literal statement. That is what he writes on the surface. And this deviation is from literal meaning to some implied meaning, some hidden meaning. The piece of poetry that is considered to be great, it means something else which lies hidden behind the words which are written on the page. It has some deeper meaning, and this is used to create or clarify some point and to create the rhetorical effect. Poet has also made use of metaphor, and the most important metaphor used in the poem is that of road. You have seen in the title itself. Road here stands for choices. And what is a metaphor? It is the use of words or phrases which literally denote one kind of object or idea, and it is used in place of another idea which is considered to be similar in characteristics. So this is a sort of comparison between two objects, an indirect way of presenting the idea by the poet. Poem has also symbols in it. For example, wood here, you have seen in the picture, wood is the forest, a literal meaning, and its symbolic meaning is wood may be considered to be the life. The forest here stands for the life, and symbol is a sign or mark that stands for or suggests something else by reason of relationship or any sort of resemblance. Poem is rich in imagery also. You will see that this is a very beautiful poem, and the beautiful images, word pictures have been created in the poem. And these word pictures are used to add depth to the work. Another poetic device that is used is alliteration. Alliteration is the repetition of initial consonant sounds in the neighboring words. For example, you are seeing here, he has used a phrase wanted wear. Here, w sound has been repeated in two consecutive words. Next device used here is consonants. Consonants means the repetition of consonant sounds in the words in one sentence or one line. Example, two roads diverged in a yellow wood. The sound has been repeated again and again. Next line is though as far as the passing there. Here th is the sound, because I didn't find any symbol in my laptop for the, so I has used these alphabets. So here the sound has been repeated. Personification is act of giving a human quality or characteristic to something which is non-human or inanimate, like our passions, our emotions, or any abstract idea. So let us now start with the poem, The Road Not Taken. As I have told you, the significance of the title, the road stands for the choices which are lying before us, and the title shows the regret of the narrator, the choice, the path which he was not taken, was not able to adopt in his life. So there is a sort of frustration which is reflected in the title itself. Because the poet has chosen this title, because the title, a comment is just like a comment on the theme. It reflects, it represents the theme of the poem itself. So the theme maybe, which is we are going to read in the poem and which we understand it, theme is the feeling of regret over the choice made. Because always this is a human tendency to hanker for the things which are not with us. So let me do the reading of the first stanza of the poem. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry, I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. Says that the narrator, the simple meaning is that he was on a journey and then he moves to a forest. He was passing through a forest and the forest was covered with yellow leaves. So yellow color here symbolizes autumn season. And then he saw that there the road, he reaches at a point, the road divides into two. So he could not understand which could be the right path, where he has to reach, which road will take him to his goal. So this literal meaning, it has a deeper meaning also. Here we can say that wood stands for the life itself. And yellow color is a symbol of sadness because the leaves are shedding their the trees are shedding their leaves. They have turned yellow. The green color so shows happiness and its opposite is yellow color. So it might be telling us about some sad moment in the life of human beings. And in our lives, we reach at some point where our path, roads, where our life reaches at some point that when we have to choose between two options. And we feel sorry for ourselves. We feel upset that we cannot take both the options simultaneously. Because we are the single travelers in this life. We are the lonely people. One traveler means it also shows the loneliness of human beings in the modern world. And because we are alone and we have to travel alone throughout our journey of life, so we have to decide what is the right option for us. And this decision is difficult. That's why long I stood, we wait and we ruminate, we think over which choice might be better and looked down one as far as I could. And we analyze all the options available before us as wisely as we can do to where it bent in the undergrowth. But our imagination is limited, our vision is limited, and we can look into the future to some extent. But after that, our vision becomes vague. We cannot see into the distant future. And this is represented by undergrowth. As the road in the forest, it then disappears in the dense growth of bushes. In the same manner, our future course of life gets disappeared in something uncertain. There lies uncertainty in our fate. And you can see the rhyme scheme. The first sentence, third and fourth sentences, they have the last sound similar. Would, stood, and could. That's why we have given it the name of AAA. And line second and fifth, they are given B and B. So this is the rhyme scheme ABAAB. Next stanza. Then took the other as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear, though as for that the passing there had warned them really about the same. So after thinking over some time, the person, the traveler, he decides ultimately, he makes a decision and he took the other road, which is different from the choice made by common people. That's why it has been called the other road, other path, because it seemed as just and as fair. It seemed a beautiful path. It seemed that its end will be beautiful. It will be beneficial. It will be satisfying for the traveler. and it seemed a right choice at that time. It seemed a reasonable choice at that time. And the person takes this choice because his wisdom tells him that this is the right choice for him, because he wanted to do something different in his life. That's why he took the other road, other path, and having perhaps the better claim. And at that moment in the life, it seemed that this road had a better claim. This road was more beneficial. This road was more suitable to his instincts, because it was grassy and wanted wear. Because grassy and wanted wear means that nobody has traveled on this road so far. Because it was grassy, it was still covered with fresh grass. The grass was not covered, not crushed by the feet of human beings. And it wanted wear. It was totally unused road. That's why he took it at that time. Because a few people had gone along this path, and this was a new beginning for him. It seemed that he would be able to discover some new things in his life, and he will be different from the common people, the common choices of the people. So he doesn't want to go along the beaten track. Rather, he wants to create a new path for himself and to prove before the world that he is an inventor. He has discovered something new. He has achieved something new. But he says that though as for the passing there had warned them really about the same. Up to that point where now he is standing, and from where the road is bifurcating into two directions, it is going into two directions. Up to this point, it was traveled by most of the people. Because he says, though as for the passing there had warned them really about the same. It seemed that the people had moved along this path in equal number, but the further journey he had to travel all alone, because a few people like to do something different in their lives, or like to take risks in their lives. Next stanza. And both that morning equally lay in leaves. No step had trodden blank. Oh, I kept the first for another day, yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. On that morning, the morning of his choice making. Morning means the fresh beginning. He was fresh. He was full of enthusiasm at that time. When we get up in the morning, we feel fresh, and we are not at all tired, and we are hopeful, we are optimistic, and we try to begin the new world with a bang, new day with a bang. In the same manner, the poet persona or the narrator here was fresh on the day of his making choice, and he saw that on that morning both the roads equally lay in leaves. On that day when he was going to make a choice, nobody has traveled along both the paths, because no step had trodden blank. The leaves were still fresh and nobody has crushed the leaves. That is, no human soul had walked in the direction, in both the directions. He say, but still he made a decision in favor of a different road. He wanted to do something different in life. He chose a different direction for his life. And he thought that I kept the first for another day. When I will have time in life, I will try to explore the other road also, which I have left behind now, which I am not choosing. But here you see the sign of exclamation, and shows the sadness that my decision, he is not satisfied with the decision which he has made, because he thought that he will return back and to restart the journey of his life. But at that time of making the choice, knowing how way leads on to way, and I doubted if I should ever come home. At that time of making choice, he knew very well that he will never come back because it is impossible to retrace our steps. Why it is so? कि हम वापस नहीं आ सकते, जिस रास्ते हम मुड़ जाते हैं, वी कैन नॉट री स्टार्ट आवर लाइव्स. बड़ा मुश्किल होता है अपनी ज़िंदगी को दोबारा से नए सिरे से शुरू करना. वाई? बिकॉज वी नो दैट वन वे लीड ऑन टू अनदर वे. वैन वी अडॉप्ट, वैन वी स्टार्ट मूविंग इन वन डायरेक्शन, देन न्यू वेज, न्यू पाथ स्टार्ट ओपनिंग. And we continuously move on and on, but there is no return. So this doubt remains there in the minds of people, in the mind of common men also, that we cannot retrace our steps. We very well know this fact, that once a choice is made, there is no returning. Even then, we hope, we have false hopes, that we may explore everything in our lives, the paths which we have renounced at one stage, we can adopt those things in the later years of our lives, but it is just impossible. That is the message of the poet in the poem. So I shall be telling this with a sigh. Somewhere ages and ages hence, two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. So this last stanza sums up the poet's philosophy, that there is a sense of discontent, there is a feeling of discontent, dissatisfaction that lurks behind our decisions. All the human beings on this earth, everybody, has this feeling of discontent, and we are never satisfied with our lives. And what life has offered us, we do not find pleasure in those things. Says in future, ages and ages hence, in future, when he will be telling his story to his next generation, so he will be telling this with a sigh, with sadness. Sadness over the difference which is lying before us between himself and the other people. So he will be telling this with a sigh, not with pleasure, not with happiness, but with sadness, that once upon a time I was young and I had many options in my life, and there was an option. I stood at a point when it became compulsory for me to decide between the two options which were lying before me, two roads diverged in a wood, and because I took the one less traveled by, and because I was bubbling with enthusiasm, with adolescence, and I wanted to achieve something different, I wanted to create something unique in life, so I decided to adopt a path which was not traveled by many people. I decided to go against the current, and that has made all the difference. And whatever I am today, I am very much different from other people. Other people have become successful in their lives, in the world of materialism. But the narrator, he feels that he might be feeling that he is left behind. Whatever difference is seen in him and the other people around him, that is because of that choice. So writer wants to say that our choice makes us whatever we are. It depends on our choice. We are given free will, and we have to decide wisely at that time. But however wisely we may decide, we are going to regret our decisions, because we cannot achieve everything in our lives. So here he might be talking about physical pleasures and spiritual needs also, that the narrator might have taken the path of spirituality, and he might have not given much importance to the physical desires. And at this stage of his life, he might be seeing that he is left behind other people. So there may be that meaning also in the poem, but the overall meaning is the writer wants to present the sense of regret. And beautiful imagery of the forest is created. The forest, beautiful forest covered in yellow leaf, the autumn season, and the grassy fields, grassy roads. All these things give the beauty to the poem. And the rhyme scheme and the use of alliteration here, it is giving the musical quality to the poem. As in this last stanza also, you see somewhere ages and ages hence. So here, there is the rhyme. So this is all about the poem, students. I hope that you might have enjoyed it. And I suggest that you read this poem again and again. You sing this poem and you will come to love it more and more. जितना आप इसको गाएंगे उतना ही आप इसको लाइक करेंगे बिकॉज इट इज कंसर्न्ड विद द लाइव्स ऑफ एवरी ह्यूमन बीइंग्स. सो टू कंक्लूड इन द वर्ड्स ऑफ रॉबर्ट फ्रॉस्ट दैट ही मेक्स यूज ऑफ मेटाफर्स सिंबल्स इन हिज पोएम्स टू प्रोवाइड वन परमिसेबल वे ऑफ सेइंग वन थिंग एंड मीनिंग अनदर एंड इट प्रेजेंट्स this poem perfectly. This poem is perfectly endowed with rural imagery, and this rural imagery is endowed with a larger symbolic and metaphysical significance. And the theme of the poem may be said to be that it has universality in it, and this is presented with an emotional authenticity of voice and technical brilliance. So here is the references used in the poem. And with that, I come to an end. I hope that you have liked it. Thank you, students. Thank you very much.